Well, I think people are initially drawn to yoga, at least I was. In the beginning, it's for the physical side of it because people are looking for a way to get in shape and look fit and be healthy, and I think that's definitely what helps get people through the door. But what keeps them there and what hooks them and keeps them coming back is once they cross over the physical part of it and they reach the mental benefits, the spiritual benefits, the healing benefits on a much deeper level. So for sure, it's probably the physical part that gets most people through the door because nobody expects that all this other good stuff's gonna come with it, but it's definitely the deeper side of it that keeps them there.
Well, Chris and I were teaching martial arts, and we had a kind of a backyard studio where we'd have a group of guys come over and pad up and go at it. And my sister had been practicing yoga for a long time, and we asked her to teach a yoga class to the group of guys, and that was our first experience, and she did a beautiful job at it, and we felt amazing afterwards, and so it sparked my interest.
Once I started practicing, it didn't take long for me to realize how powerful it was in terms of healing the body, but we were always practicing martial arts with the intention of dissolving the ego and being able to see clearly when you're in a confrontation, and I realized that, and through this practice of yoga, that it was like the rocket ship to the place we were going, where in one class it took years for me to achieve that state of presence or stillness in the midst of the martial arts world, and within one or two classes I had experienced it and realized that there was something more than just the physical healing of it. It was the space that was created in my mind and body that felt just amazing.
It ended up being something that helped me get out of my head. And I think that a lot of our insecurities and fears come from us believing the thoughts that are in our heads all the time. And yoga helped me, whether it was for a second or 5 seconds, or sometimes even for a minute, helped me quiet those thoughts down. And till this day, you know, I still have those thoughts. But I have a lot more tools through my yoga practice to help me see that those thoughts aren't always reality.
For me, it was really the physicality of it when I was little. It was like, you know, I grew up really athletic and played a lot of really competitive tennis and running and ballet as well. And so as a 14-year-old girl coming to yoga, it was very much that physicality of it, of that connection to, you know, like the blood pumping in your veins and that physicality that you get in sports as well. I think as a teenage girl too, it was also that kind of making peace with being present in your body and being comfortable in your skin. And there's so much going through your head as a teenage girl, and so many, I mean, I don't know if there's anyone who would want to go back to being 14 again, all the stuff that you go through as a kid. But just being able to have some like moments of comfort in my own skin.
I was in college, and I remember always reading magazines and all the famous, beautiful actresses said they did yoga. And it always irritated me because I always thought yoga was this stretchy thing. And I'm like, you don't look that good because you do yoga. Stop lying. And so it's just a weird mental memory that I have. And then I started practicing it in college. I went to University of Virginia, and we had the aquatic and fitness center. And then a girlfriend of mine who was in musical theater, she went off for the summer and did this ballet camp, and they did yoga. And she came back, she's like, oh my God, there's this thing called yoga, and we have to do it. So she found a local Ashtanga studio, and we started going there. And it became the highlight of my week, and I started scavenging as much money as I could and started going twice a week. And by the time I graduated, I thought, you know, I think I want to learn how to teach this, because I still wanted to act at that point. I'm going to move to Los Angeles, go to Hollywood, become a big star, and learn how to teach yoga to make money in between.
I've always been very, very physically active, so and that might actually be more instilled in me from my mother, because I think maybe I might have been a lot to handle as a kid, just energy-wise. So she made sure to put me through physical activities before bedtime. So, you know, I did baseball head-on for a good 5-6 years, played hockey for a good 5 or 6 years, religiously. You know, that was like, those were my sports. And I think I've always needed something physical to at least allow me to sleep and allow me to calm down, because I think there's a lot that goes on in my head. So it's always been a good way of chilling out, really, just working myself physically. Back in August of 2007, I actually started working for a company called Lululemon, a little tiny company. And at the time, they would allow their full-time employees to take any form of a physical fitness class for free. They pay for it, they reimburse you the money. And so I did kickboxing. I was already a gym rat, going to the gym all the time, doing all that. And I just happened to be asked to go to a yoga class. It was Vinyasa Flow level 2-3. And I just remember, probably 40 minutes in, I already think, I've never had my butt handed to me like this before. Sweat all over the floor, and inversion time came around like an hour and 5 minutes in, and my inversion was being supine, just laying down on my back and looking at the ceiling. And she came around and was like, "Are you okay?" I said, "Oh, I feel great. I've never felt this good before, but have to relax." And, you know, I've never had to say, "I need to relax," after pitching over and over again, or playing hockey for an hour and a half. I never thought, "Oh, I'm tired, I need to chill out." That was the first time something had ever made me like, "I need to relax, I need to chill." And so I think that's really what kind of grabbed me so much, is that physically I felt not exhausted, but so worked that mentally I felt for the first time, I can relax. So I think that's what really grabbed me. That was my first experience.
I just like seen this sign for yoga, and so I started going, and it was just like, I remember it was a class of these 60-year-old women. There were probably like four of us, and eventually my teacher invited me to practice at his house, and I didn't really know it that much at the time, but we were doing Ashtanga, and it was like, you know, there were four of us just breathing in this small room, and just that like connection to the life force and the breath, and like that movement was captivating to me.
You know, I think so many people get into yoga for so many different reasons, and I'm not scared to say that mine was very, very physical. And I think part of what I love about yoga still is very physical. Through that physicality, I find a little more mental clarity. So that's really what got me hooked. I think I was hooked that day one, honestly, because the next day I took a day off, but then from then on I went every day. 3 months later, teacher training. I mean, I knew. It's one of those things for me, normally if I decide to do something, I really do go 100%. Even though my wife might say that I'm fairly indecisive about certain things, I'm indecisive about things that I'm skeptical about. Maybe I'm more skeptical about things, I mean, about myself when it comes to certain things. But when it came to yoga, I was like, I want to do this because it makes me feel good, and I want to share this with other people, at least how I feel.
It just felt good, honestly. It was kind of that simple. I've always been in tune with my body. I was a tomboy ever since I was a little girl, so I've always been very athletic. And then I moved into theater, where I'm not a trained dancer, but, you know, give me the choreography and I'll figure it out by the time the curtain goes up. And it was really exciting to, one, my teacher, she was this beautiful, I don't know how old she was, but she had this long gray braid and the most beautiful, graceful, strong body I'd ever seen. And I just really looked up to her, and she was so graceful, and I wanted to possess that as well. I loved the potential that I saw every time I went for growths and strengths and things that I didn't know I was capable of doing. And I was 20 or 21, or I don't even remember when I was 19 or something like that. So I don't know if I could really wrap my brain around what it actually meant, aside from, I want to do more. Like, give me more of this. This is great.
It was once I started doing it consistently. Before that, because I was only doing 1 to 2 days a week, I felt it, but it wasn't enough to notice something deeper going on initially. When I started upping the practice and realizing that 5 days a week felt better in my body and my mind, then it was when I would shift back into the 1 day a week or 2 days a week, it was the, there's something missing here. There's that feeling that I'm missing from, and I didn't even put two and two together in the beginning that it was the practice, but it didn't take too long for me to wake up and realize that.
I started going more regularly, and then I actually was in a car accident and it hurt my back really badly, and so I started using I went through physical therapy and it didn't really help, and so I started doing my yoga practice more and was realizing how much that was helping. There weren't really any yoga teachers or studios at the time. This was like 16, 17 years ago, and So I decided I wanted to become a teacher, and I'd kind of been playing with teaching friends and family, and I liked the idea of it, and so I went and decided to start teaching. And at that point, it became a very regular practice, of course, ever since.
The shift from wanting to be an actress to a yoga teacher was almost immediate, because I grew up in Kansas, and Midwestern people are just really nice. So it was a bit of a shock going to Hollywood. And, you know, I had that stereotypical response that you always hear about, where I went and I met with the manager, and she looked at me and said that the weight that you're at right now, you could be the funny best friend. And if you want to be the ingenue, you know, I hate to say it, but you definitely gotta lose weight. And I was so young and so beautiful and in really good shape. And so to hear that, I just remember going home thinking, do I need to starve myself? Do I need to, like, do the cigarette and coffee diet that everyone seems to do here? And simultaneously, I was doing my yoga training. Hollywood rejecting me and making me feel like I was lacking, while simultaneously yoga was showing me you're perfect and you have everything that you need already. So it didn't take me long to realize I don't want this.
My mom and dad were kind of hippies without the drugs. You know, they were on their spiritual paths, especially my father. He was he taught us about meditation at a really young age, and that didn't negate the fact that you're still dealing with yourself, right? I still have to sit and be with myself, to practice and understand myself better, and to see my neuroses and my quirks and my dysfunctions, and then take honest stock of myself. Do I want to live with this, right? Do I want to live with these, my little crazies, or do I want to shine awareness on them and be more skillful? So there was lots of hurdles, you know, meditation practices where you feel like there's a person trapped in your head, just chattering away, and you're like, why? Why are you tormenting me? You know, it's any spiritual practice or any consistent practice with knowing yourself is going to have those hurdles. It's part of the path, I think.
You know, even today, like if I talk about yoga, I still talk about the physical side of everything. But I think mentally, I mean, yoga has kind of, it's allowed me to not only self-reflect, but also self-reflect on the things that maybe negative patterns that I have. And I mean, that in itself is a mental thing, to really think about yourself, and not in such a, not necessarily in a positive light, but in a way that's not necessarily things that you need to fix about yourself, but just being more self-reflective and really seeing whatever it is, whatever reactions I have to other people, how that affects other people, and what place or what position I play. I look at her because we talk about this often. But what position I play in the things that go around me, especially with my family and the people that I affect. I was always taught to be very courteous to people, be kind to people, and be conscious of others around you. And that was instilled in me by my mother. But I think yoga has kind of really pulled even more out of me, in the sense that I need to really be conscious of how I react and what I do, and in turn, by kind of making myself a better person, I think those around me maybe will become better people as well.
And this is the thing with yoga. If you, and it's kind of goes along with that ignorance is bliss idea, that when you don't know, you think you're fine, and you think everything's great, and I don't need anything. And then you go and take a yoga class, and you realize how much better you feel after the yoga class, and you look at the state where you thought everything that was okay, and you realize, whoa, there's so much more, and there's such a heightened awareness that I can get to where I'm really ecstatically, blissfully happy. And I was taking a class the other night where I'd never taken this class before, and I went in there and I wanted to work. You know, I wanted to sweat, I wanted to flow, I wanted my vinyasas, like that was the mood that I was in. And the class was slow and very alignment driven, which is great, but it wasn't what I wanted. So for the first half hour of the class in my brain, I'm like, damn it, this isn't what I I could have done a practice at home, blah, 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 and you've got this whole conversation, aka life happening in your head. And just being a little snotty bitch, honestly, judging everything. And then by the end of the practice, and you do it, and you do your shavasana, and you sit up, and you go, wow, this is exactly what I needed. This is exactly what I needed. And the yoga practice has allowed me to trust that the situations that I'm in are there for a very specific reason, even if it doesn't align with what my ego or my brain wants. And if I can stop tearing everything to shreds and judging it and expecting it to be a certain way, that there's a lot to get out of your life.
It's kind of always for me been that ability to take this knowledge, and one of the things I love doing, I'm so like the nerdy aspect of it, of like learning and analyzing and taking it and being able to then take that and share that with people, to give people these tools, because it's the physicality of it, but then eventually that ability to sink into something deeper that is almost unexplainable. And this is the thing, you know, I do a lot of yoga for athletes, and this is one of the things that I love, is that it's like replicating the zone, you know, that ability to get into the zone, which in athletics is like, it's like gold, and that ability to recreate that in our lives. And it's not even about a sport anymore, but that zone is the presence that we talk about as yogis, the dharana, the dhyana, that ability to be absorbed within the process of our lives, to be absorbed in it. And to me, that practice of yoga is about having the clarity within our lives to clarify and get really clear in our purpose, and start to pursue the things that we love, because we all have this passion of some sort within us. And it doesn't mean that we all have to become yoga teachers, or that we're all meant to like become yogis every day, all day long. But the idea is that yoga helps us clarify our purpose and start to get clear in ourselves and look at our shit. You know, it's like there's so much stuff swirling around in our brains at any given moment that skews the lens through which we see the world. And so yoga, a lot of it is just about like the windshield wipers of clearing that off, so that we can sit and look clearly. And one of the things I love about it is that balance between like the nerdy, brainy, like dissect it, look at it, we can get really physical about it, and I love the anatomy and dissecting all of this stuff and getting really geeky about it. But then eventually it's like we just let that go.
Yoga is just like anything else that you do, in the sense that there's always room for improvement. I think yoga can just be harsher, in the sense that it's right there. You're dealing with yourself, whether it's your physical body and limitations or mental limitations for that moment or that day, but it's right there in your face. You're on this mat, and that's all you have to work with. So, you know, one day you could be feeling great. You're moving through the practice. Everything feels good, and you're doing poses deeper and stronger than you ever have. And the next day, sometimes it just kicks your butt and it's just not happening. So it forces you every day, every moment, to really deal with yourself.
It mentally slaps you back into, you know what? This is what's good for you. And this is the kind of person that you want to be. And that's why people keep going back to it. You get hooked, because at the soul of things, we all want to be a good, full, happy person. The common thing that we're all searching for is enlightenment, right? Or happiness. And yoga has taught me that the key to enlightenment and happiness is the ability to embrace each moment as it arrives, and each breath as it enters and comes into your body and exits. And it's not, is this what I want it to be? Is this the person I want to be with? Is this the job I want to have? Is this the picket fence that I want to go around my house? But rather, what is happening in front of me at this moment? And when we can let go of the reaction and the judgment and just observe, then you're out of that headspace, and you're like, this is fantastic.
I remember vividly one shavasana, at the end of one class, I had an experience of complete stillness. It was the experience of being completely aware. It wasn't like checked out, catatonic, like I'm in this dreamy state. It was totally present, completely aware. And I, for whatever reason, I was able to stay there for the length of my shavasana. It was probably 5 minutes. And that shifted my whole understanding of what I was doing in the practice. It was the moment of, this isn't just move your body here, move your body there, get strong, get flexible. It was, there's something that it's taking me towards within me, and it's not outside of myself, it was within me. And that was the first realization that what I'm looking for I already have, And the way to experience it wasn't to look outside of myself and start getting deeper and stronger and more flexible and faster. It was to get calmer, to slow down, to quiet the mind, and to realize that we have everything we need.
And I know that in the next 50 years, there are going to be these points that yoga, that I realize why yoga is in my life, where it really gets me again and again, and it reaffirms why I live a yoga life and I do yoga every day or I teach it. It's because it does, you do come across those points in life over and over again that remind you how important yoga is to you.
I think the reason why I went through all those different sports, and I'm not saying I got really good at those sports, but I feel like I was pretty decent at them, but I would drop them at the dime, at the drop of a hat, because I think I got bored a lot with doing the same repetitive thing. And with yoga, at least, for me, in the yoga practice, I've discovered there's so many elements to yoga, whether it's pranayama, different styles, ashtanga, iyengar, flow, inversional yoga. It changes constantly. And not only does it change, I just feel like it gives me the opportunity to change constantly. So that's why I think I love it. That's why I love my personal practice, because it can change all the time. There's no like mastering anything, because once you feel like you've mastered something, there's another way to connect what you feel like you've mastered into something else, you know? I love a physical practice that's inverted all the time, so now I've started to find more backbending and hip opening, you know, and not necessarily that I mastered those, but if I find those, all of a sudden I might find myself more into enjoying very restorative classes, you know. So I think what I love about the yoga practice, or my personal practice, is that it's ever changing. It's never gonna end. I'm glad that there's no end goal.
So many times in our lives we get so focused on an end point. And yoga, it's like, even the physicality of it, it's like we keep coming back and then you're like, yeah, I got this, and then it slaps you right in the face and you're like, now do this. And you're like, at some point you realize, okay, like I'm never gonna be able to do everything. And then we start to go, okay, maybe I just get caught up in the process and enjoy and be present in it. And you know, there's so many little bits like that that we learn that replicate right into our lives. And it's just, it's so analogous to everything that we do that it's such an incredible tool, I think, for everyone.
It's such a pivotal thing in life that if people can get past the preconceived notions that they have of what yoga is, because yoga has survived forever, basically, and for a very specific reason. And it's, I like to compare it to Madonna, that it's always changing and it adjusts with the times and it's always reinventing itself. And that's what's so magical about it, is that you can have an Iyengar student next to an Ashtanga student, and if they sit down and talk to each other, they're going to say, my way is the right way, no, my way is the right way, back and forth. But at the end of the day, it doesn't matter, because they found this style of yoga that served them and that gets them to that higher place or that mental place or that place where I'm a better person, except for when they're arguing with the other yogi about what's right. So yoga is for everyone, period. And a lot of people have that reaction of, well, I'm too old, or I'm not flexible enough, I'm not strong enough, da-da-da, whatever it is that goes down the list. And it simply boils down to judgment, because say you're not flexible or strong, and all you can see is pictures of people doing handstands. And in your head, that's yoga, or that's what media is trying to portray as yoga. And that's called ego. And that's excuses. And that's saying, well, this offends me, so I'm not gonna even try it. And the sooner people can get past what offends them in anything beyond, whether it's an action sport or a personal relationship or yoga, once you realize this, when you get offended, it's like an excuse to not do what you really wanna do.
Through your training, you have to relinquish the ego. If the ego gets involved, your clarity of thinking is gone. Your cognitive ability just disappears because emotion takes over and grips you. Of course, it comes up. You know, you get into a class and you're doing a, you know, a pose that you always do, and you can't do it one day, and you're like, what's wrong with me? I should be able to do this pose. This is, you know, the whole mind shatters. So it's there still. You know, it's not like I have no ego now, but it's always there, and there's a healthy part of it. You know, there's a healthy side to the ego. It's the part of us that forces us to put clothes on in the morning. It makes us, you know, clean our, you know, brush our hair and look presentable for the world, you know. There's that side of it, but it can rear its ugly head sometimes, you know.
It really comes back to this lack of judgment, and I think that's why the world is where it is right now. There's just so much judgment, and I'm right, and not being able to listen to the other person, and greed, and if we can just drop that and breathe, and that ability to step into the moment and say, hey, this is where it's at right now, that's where the strength comes from, and it's inspiring, and it's contagious. And when people go to a yoga class, they feel better. And when you feel better, you go home and you behave better.
It's not so much for me about the style or the practice. I can appreciate many different styles and many different levels and many different things, but being able to open my eyes and look at what's going on and be really present within that process is what's important. And so I think my practice is much more well-rounded. I think there's definitely more meditation now, definitely more than when I was 16 and I was kind of forced to do it and I hated it. I can definitely appreciate more of the sitting and the pranayama, but I still have a strong physical practice. It's just less important to me, the showy stuff. You know, they're fun, and I enjoy teaching them, and it brings us into the moment to understand them, and I love the kind of nerdy dissection of how to do them. But in my own personal practice, it's kind of like it's a nice balance of, you know, the physicality with that mental inward place that I think is so important. And I think that's the beauty of yoga, is it just changes so much as you change, and it can be what you need for that day. You know, it's like being able to understand enough to take what you need, I think, is a beautiful thing.
You know, there's yoga where you sit and meditate all day, and there's yoga where you're doing nonstop activity to hip hop music. And who's to say what's wrong and right? Because if Tupac Shakur is your gateway to enlightenment, awesome. At least Tupac got you there. So just let people have what they need and let go of your idea of what's right or wrong.
Lao Tzu writes that the path forward seems to go back and the path into the light seems dark. And when I decided to be aware of certain, you know, psychosomatic, like things I hold on to in my mind, and when I started realizing that I want to be free of that, the first thing you notice is all the things that keep you bonded to it. And so it's challenging because the only choice is, well, I guess there's two choices. You can walk into it and see it for what it is, or you can turn away and run. But turning away and running is just avoiding it, and it's going to come back to you. You know, it always cycles through. So it's challenging, but there's no other, I feel like the discomfort and the pain that you have to address, that's we all hold on some level because of whatever reason. The only way to really live a full life is to like lean into that discomfort and lean into the pain, because without it you numb joy and you numb love and you numb the experience of belonging and all of the other beautiful things that life is about.
It definitely changes how you look at situations. It definitely changes how you handle situations because you have more tools now, but it also means that you see more and you're aware of more. So there are still times where, you know, your demons come back and haunt you, and a lot of times, like even for me this past week, knowing that I need to go and meditate and sit on my cushion, knowing that I need that is also when I'm scared to do it, because I know there's stuff that's going to come up for me and stuff that needs to be dealt with. So it's kind of a double-edged sword, but the thing is, it always moves you forward. Moving through those hard times and dealing with what you have to deal with that previously you may have been unaware of or wouldn't have been able to see, it allows you to work through it and move through it and, in essence, move your life forward rather than just being ignorant to it.
I find it really difficult, in my own experience, to teach people to just sit down and be still. It's difficult. It's hard. We've had meditation classes that you have and meditation sounds so mysterious. It's like, I want to be, you know, you see the monks sitting in the cave and on the mountain, and it's like, whoa, that seems so mysterious. I want to try that. And so we'll have a meditation class, and, you know, 30 people will show up to it. The next day, 15 people will show up. The next class, 5 or 6 will show up, because it's real work. The mystique disappears real quick when you sit there and you're like, holy shit, I have to sit with myself. You know, I have to actually be with myself and see my craziness do its thing, right? If they can even see that, right? That's to even get the separation to know that I'm not my thoughts, right? I'm not this chattering monkey in my head doing its thing, right? I'm deeper than that. But so the beauty, I think, of asana, of the physical practice, is that you get people moving, right? You don't have to talk about being still and watching, paying attention to your breath and being the witness of the chatter, right? Which is very difficult for where society is right now. You say, get on your mat, put your right foot here, put your left hand here, set your gaze here, breathe, and it happens.
In everyday life, if we pay attention to our breath, and you know, for a lot of us, it may be through yoga, it may be through meditation, it could be running, you know, when you pay attention to that, you realize how much control you have over your life and the way you feel and just your own sanity, rather than letting things bombard you and crowd you out and, you know, pull you down essentially, rather than dealing with it through alcohol or drugs or other things, you choose to deal with it through your breath. And what's so great about yoga is that it almost teaches us in disguise how to do that. It starts with the physical practice and the movement, and the teacher's just saying, inhale, step your right foot forward, exhale, you know, and it's almost like tricking you into breathing. But at the end of the day, what it comes back to is your breath. Your breath controls your movement. It controls your actions. It controls what comes out of you. And essentially, we can take control of that back rather than letting our environment control it.
Yoga is huge in the modern day life. I think it's so easy to get caught up in the things that we do, and the to-do list and the checklist and the goals, which is great. You know, we need those things. But it really is a process of opening our eyes to what's going on, I feel like. And you know, sometimes it's great, you know, we sit in our yoga practice and we can set up this perfect environment and sit on pillows and play nice music. But eventually shit comes up in our lives, whether it's on the street walking through New York City or, you know, in Kansas or wherever you are. It's that, you know, the things come up and I think it's easy within the world for us to stuff that away and not ever look at that. And yoga, for me, part of it is the process of looking really deeply and without judgment. It's not like, oh, I'm a bad person because I did this or I did that or because my mind wanders all the time. We all do it. It's like you get to know all these yoga people. We all have the same problems. But the whole point is that as yogis, we're willing to look at that. We're willing to look and own up to our shit. And I think that that's one of the most important things. And as we start to do that, we start to take accountability for our lives and start to look at where we're going, and instead of really focusing so much on the end point is getting caught up in that. And I think, you know, as a healthcare practitioner, that's where a lot of we see this now in a lot of our healthcare, is this stress and how much of a toll it takes on our bodies. And stress is just, it's just our resistance to what's happening. It's our resistance to just being in the moment. That's one of the most valuable things that yoga has to offer, is that ability to really bring us deeply into ourselves, whether it's good or bad or right or wrong or here or there, that ability to bring us really deeply into ourselves and really deeply into the moment to appreciate our lives and what we have and be grateful for what we have, because we have so much, and it's so easy to live in a world of deficit rather than a world of abundance. And I think it reminds us that both of those exist, that sometimes things are shitty, but that we still have all of this abundance in our lives, and to be present within the mutual existence of both of those is the beauty of it.
For people, it can just be about the physical, and they can just work that, and they can get to a level of peace in their lives. But then the next step is to let yourself really be still, right? To sit down on the cushion, close your eyes, and be with yourself. The work that, in my experience, the work I do on my cushion is like a rocket ship compared to the work I do on my mat. So I think even for like people that don't even, like people that are, you know, working in the city, rocking out their jobs and type A, going, I feel the asana practice is really is a better first step for them. get them on a mat, get them moving, let somebody take over as a teacher for them and tell them to do this and didn't do this and do this and do this. And so they can let go of the control, they can just let themselves be in a class and move through their bodies. And then they can start feeling again. So that's the first step. We gotta start feeling again. We gotta get out of here and get into here, so that we can move on down the path.
I just think the world would be a completely different place if people did yoga. I think that if not necessarily that all of a sudden the world would be a perfect place, but I think that if everyone started to understand themselves and what motivates them and drives them and get really clear in their purpose. I think a lot of what we do as human beings is autopilot. It's a projection of where we've been and what's happened to us. And unfortunately, we end up just kind of going through the motions of our lives and then, you know, coming to the end and wondering what happened. And for me, yoga is this process of waking up and looking really clearly and examining our lives. And I think that if more people were able to do this, I think it would be a huge movement in the world. I think if everyone did yoga, it would be a completely different place to live. And it's not about being perfect, you know, because we're never gonna be perfect. It's not about trying to live up to some yogic standard, which you know, can feel like the case sometimes, I think from some perspectives. It's really about letting go of that judgment and looking really clearly at what is us and what is important and getting really clear in that. And I think that with that in mind, I think it changes everything.
I've realized that life is more fulfilling, even in all of its discomfort and pain and, you know, loss. It's, if I'm not embracing it as well as the pleasure and the love and the joy of it all, then I'm missing half of the equation. And it's not that I want pain or loss to come into my life, but it's gonna happen because that's the nature of the world. And if I can lean into it, then I have more gratitude, I have more joy, I have more, it's a more fulfilling life to be lived, really. And I think, so on a personal level, that's why it's worth keeping going and just keeping one foot in front of the other and stepping into the path.
It doesn't take years of practice to see the benefits of yoga. I mean, I've had a regular practice, I would say consistent practice, for only a few years. So, you know, compared to some others that have decades or a lifetime of practice in meditation, it's not a lot, but it can still have huge benefits. And, you know, as a result, for myself personally, I see changes day in and day out. You know, they aren't always huge, but I'm that much more aware and that much more receptive to it as a result. And everyone can relate to that in some way. I think it's easiest when you think of athletes. Like, I was a competitive swimmer most of my life, and there was still that same focus and honing into the moment that you have to do any activity. But what yoga allows you to do is to do it anywhere, anytime, you know, in just a few seconds. Just pause and get into that moment and really drop in, rather than having to go through a 2-hour workout, you know, and essentially like exhausting yourself to the point where you just can't think of anything else.
My favorite is when people, if I sit next to someone on a plane and they ask me what I do, and I say, oh, I teach yoga. And they go, oh, do you do anything else? It's funny, it's a really hard thing to explain to someone who has no grasp, because I think if you're in the yoga world, like in Los Angeles, for example, if you say you're a yoga teacher, people are like, oh my gosh, where do you teach? Blah, 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 blah. And it is kind of a celebrity thing in these big urban cities. But you go outside of that and you get that reaction of, oh, do you work at the YMCA? You know, like this idea of, it sounds like a hobby to most people and not a career. And it has become a career for people. And when I go around traveling, I see people leaving high-paid jobs to do yoga teacher trainings because they're happy there and they're realizing that's their joy and that's their happiness, and that it isn't the dollar sign anymore. It's like, this is what I want to do. So it's kind of the poster child for me of happiness and pursuing what you really want and what makes your heart beat, as opposed to, this is what society has told me I need to do, and this is how much money I should be making at this age, and these are the amount of babies I should have pumped up by now. And yoga allows you to be you. So it's, and it allows to be the fittest, most spiritually connected version of you. And it can be a workout. And if you choose to use yoga as a workout, that's great. That's fine. If you do yoga long enough, even if you're choosing to use it as a workout, it will become spiritual for you, though. In the same way that I think any athlete, it is spiritual, especially someone who's good at it. You don't get really good doing anything unless it evokes emotion out of you. Because if it doesn't, you'd stop doing it. It wouldn't matter. It wouldn't be important. You move on to the next thing. So it's when people say it's a body, mind, spirit experience, for real, it's phenomenal in that way. And how cool to get all of that experience in one arena.
I think yoga is the study of yourself, you know, in many different, in all the different layers. It's the physical study and the asana practice and the study of the mind and the study of the spirit, and it can be as much or as little as you want it to be. I always think it's funny when I travel to places where people still are hung up on this idea of like the yoga body, or I'm too tight, or in there, you know, in New York and LA and the West Coast, like we don't really think about that anymore. I feel like yoga's been around for so long in those areas that we all know, like, the people who are tight are the ones that need it the most. Like, those are the people, and I used to work with a lot of athletes too, and so it's like, it's so helpful for them. But there's still, in some of those places, like in the Midwest and in Europe and in other countries, there's still, like, you know, maybe 10 years behind us, and like, still with that of like, I need to be loose, I need to do this, I need to be a certain way, when yoga is for every body, it's for every person. And I think even more so for the people who are tight, even more so for the people who are athletes or sit at computers or who have been through trauma in their lives. I think most people come to yoga in a place of kind of searching, of sometimes feeling lost or feeling broken or feeling like we don't live up to some kind of expectation in our lives, and kind of searching, and it's not necessarily, you know, some people are still caught up on it being a certain religion or dogma or way, but it really is what you create of it. It's the ability to take these tools that, you know, we've used for so many years and to start to create yourself and to start to look at yourself and how the things that we do and the things that we say and the things that we eat and the things that we, how we interact, how all of these things affect us and how they kind of shape us and how much, like, everything that we see in our lives is